Was just there at the right time, and I happen to be have a camera. I just have a documentation of what I got involved in.
Up and down this floor, when you're talking to me.
I came from Germany. I arrived in the New York Harbor on November 20th. 1959, and I arrived in Detroit the next day on the train. I had an interest in taking pictures when I got my camera. Before I left East Germany, I bought a camera, and ever since then I took pictures mostly for family purposes, you know, to send home snapshots. I was interested in jazz, not so much taking pictures, but I was interested in jazz. And when I came here, I was too young to go to any clubs, plus I didn't know the language or how to get around. But then I met my first husband, John Sinclair, on campus of Wayne State University. I was a student there, and he had come from Flint, moved to the campus at Wayne to go to graduate school. He already knew a lot of musicians, and I just kind of started hanging on. Then later on, I used it more seriously. In a way, we were very political, but not in the overt sense, like going out on the streets and demonstrating, you know. We expressed it in art and poetry and generally just in, you know, turning our back on the dominant society and culture and trying to do our own thing. There with our politics. Black Panther Party telling the white radicals, no, you can't join the Black Panther Party, but you should start your own organization and start organizing your own people, because, you know, white people, that's where the problem is. So we had already been doing that, organizing young white youth through the MC5 and political rhetoric from the MC Jesse Crawford. So we felt kind of that Huey P. Newton was calling us to do something about it. So we decided, hey, we're gonna be the White Panther Party and do what they are doing, but in the white community.
This is a live phone call from Jackson.
Hey, can you say hello to 15,000 people? Listen to this.
Well, I'm just wiped out. I don't even know what to say. Say something to me first. Right?
So if you're there or not?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Oh.
You want to go away? We're waiting here for you to get out.
Oh, yeah. I'm waiting to come out, you know?
John Sinclair got arrested because he was a thorn in the eye of the Detroit Police Department, because he was kind of dubbed the king of the hippies, you know? And so the conservative parents blamed John Sinclair if their kids started smoking weed, you know, so he was kind of really a thorn in the eye of the authorities. So when John got out of the penitentiary or out of the Detroit House of Correction in 1966, we started an organization called LEMA, which is an organization that Allen Ginsberg and his friends had started in New York many years before, like in the early 60s. It stood for legalized marijuana. It was like the beginning of calling for the end of prohibition, okay? So we started a chapter in Detroit, and of course, as soon as we did, we got infiltrated again by the undercover agents. And then they set up this bus. This young hippie lady asked John for a couple of joints one night, and he said, here, being the night helping the damsel in distress out with a couple of joints. But it turned out she was a police officer, and then we got busted for the two joints. During that time, between the bust and between the time it came to trial, we only got more famous and got more followers. For instance, by that time we had managed the MC5 and they were getting more and more popular. We were working with the Grandy Ballroom. We had our own newspapers and everything. So we were still considered very powerful in terms of organizing young people. And so the judge wanted to make example out of John. Like, if you mess with marijuana, you could go to jail for life, you know. He was first charged with distribution, which is giving somebody some marijuana is called sale and distribution. And so he was facing 20 to life. Back then, the penalty was 20 to life for distribution. And so the judge didn't think he could get a conviction if the jury knew that he was facing life, so he reduced the charges to possession, and the maximum for possession was 10 years, and so he used the maximum he could under the law to teach Mr. Sinclair a lesson to not flaunt the law. We were like a bunch of lost sheep. We lost our leader. None of us counted that he would have to go, that they would keep him in jail. We thought, you know, okay, so he was sentenced and he would get out on appeal bond. Even our lawyer thought he would get appeal bond. But then it took us 2.5 years to finally get appeal bond on this charge. After the law was already changed, they finally let him out on appeal after 2.5 years. As soon as he went in, we were starting to fight and try to get him out. We knew he would get out sooner or later because the times were changing. It might have taken a little bit longer, but we worked very hard on all different aspects, like on street demonstrations and fundraising and benefits, but also there was a whole bunch of lawyers in Detroit, progressive lawyers who worked pro bono, like without getting paid, and working on motions and working on this case. And then we also had a lobbying effort in the Michigan legislature, and we convinced the senators after 2.5 years, we convinced the senators and the governor to change the law. And after we changed the law, it was 1 year for possession maximum and 4 years instead of 20 to life. It was a whole group effort, working on getting John out, you know, and then we had benefits. Almost every band in Detroit or in Michigan played a benefit to free John Sinclair at one time or another, you know. They were just all so supportive. And then to top it off, we had this big rally in Ann Arbor. When John Lennon and Yoko Ono came to help us out.
We came here not only to help John and to spotlight what's going on, but also to show and to say to all of you that apathy isn't it, and that we can do something. Okay, so flower power didn't work, so what? We start again. this song I wrote for John Sinclair.
It started out with Jerry Rubin, who had befriended John and Yoko in New York. After they moved to New York, they became friends with some of the yuppies. And Jerry Rubin told them about John Sinclair being in jail for 10 years in Michigan. And John Lennon took an interest in it because he himself had a marijuana case from London, you know, so he was very sympathetic. So he wrote a song about it called Free John Sinclair. When he found out through Jerry Rubin that we had already big benefit planned in Ann Arbor, John Lennon and Yoko volunteered to come and headline the concert. After John Lennon announced that he was going to go to the John Sinclair Freedom Rally, we got a call from Stevie Wonder asking him if he could come too. And that's how Steve Wonder, he brought his whole band and his entourage of 40 people and paid for everything to be there for John. There was Bob Seger. Bob Seger was supposed to headline the show. If John Lennon hadn't come, Bob Seger would have been the headliner. And there was Commander Cody, and of course there were all the speakers, like even Bobby Seale from the Black Panther Party came to speak. Of course, the concert helped, you know, raise the consciousness, because this was, you know, big. This was the first concert John Lennon played since he moved to America, you know. It was big. Big news.
Seeing 15,000 people in one place demanding freedom for John Sinclair.
And this death culture country of ours.
Unite revolutionary politics and rock.
To building a new nation and a new people.
Community. That's what we've got tonight, and that's what we'll carry out of here.
We need John to help us rise up like a hurricane, to sweep this man Nixon and his war makers into the sea. We need John.
What happened?
I don't know, man. They just told me to go.
We couldn't believe it happened today.
I couldn't either.
What did they do? Suddenly call you and say,
yes,
you can go?
Yes. I heard it on the radio.
Hi, John.
Hi, Lenny.
Oh, God. Thanks, man. Thanks for doing this.
It was all of us. It's just great, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, God. This is so perfect.
Nobody can believe it.
It's true.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful.
But the beautiful thing is John Lennon didn't know. The change in the law happened on December 9th when the Supreme Court of Michigan announced that they had struck down the old marijuana law. The concert happened the next day, December 10th, on a Friday night. And so 3 days later, on Monday morning, the state of Michigan all of a sudden granted John Sinclair a appeal bond and he could walk out of Jackson Prison. That's because the law was changed. John Lennon and Yoko Ono didn't know that. I didn't even know that until later, that was already in the works, that he would get out, you know. But it was such a coincidence that it happened 3 days later, and I'm still wondering to this day who in the Department of Corrections was the person who signed the papers to let him out right then and there after John Lennon came. I wonder if it was a Beatles fan.
Down.